Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
So we have a tradition that I kind of adopted from the Methodist tradition growing up in the Methodist church. So on Easter Sunday, when I say Christ is risen, you say he has risen indeed. Okay, let's practice. Christ is risen.
He has risen indeed.
Good, again. Christ is risen.
He has risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
He has risen indeed.
Okay, good. Yeah, Easter Sunday is truly the foundation for Christianity. Jesus' victory in the resurrection is, God finally had the condition to work profoundly in this world because of Jesus' sacrifice and Jesus' love. So, well, I just quickly review. This week has been Holy Week. Last week, James spoke about Palm Sunday, Jesus coming into the city of Jerusalem on Sunday, just the last week of his life. And on Monday, he's immediately out there stirring up trouble, right? He goes to the money changers and turns over their tables and chases them out of the temple. And then Tuesday and Wednesday, we read that he, Tuesday and Wednesday was teachings. He went up to the Mount of Olives and he gave them lots of warnings about the challenges that they were going to face in the future and what was to come. You really see Jesus investing in trying to prepare them for the challenges that they'd face in the future. And Thursday, our Christian tradition is called Holy Thursday, Jesus washes the feet of his disciples, encouraging them to be a true leader. You need to be a servant leader to care for the people that you're responsible for. And of course, we have the sacrament of Holy Communion, where Jesus breaks bread and he says, "Do this in remembrance of me." And then that evening in the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus prays desperately, trying to make the last condition of unity with his disciples, and yet we see the disciples sleep and don't unite and support him in his prayer. And Jesus prays desperately for God's sake, because he knows God's providence is going to be delayed if he has to go the way of the cross. He prays for the Jewish people, the chosen people, recognizing that because he has to go to the cross, they're going to go, all that foundation that they'd laid had been lost, and they will suffer incredibly. And for the Christians, those who follow him, the Christianity will be built on the blood of martyrs and sacrifice. So, unfortunately, Jesus ends up going to the cross. They take him. He's taken to the Roman courts, the Pontius Pilate. He sees Herod, and the Roman soldiers eventually take him to the place of Golgotha, where he's crucified. And that's the Good Friday, Crucifixion Friday. Here's what the divine principle has to say about the crucifixion. Satan knew that the primary goal of God's 4,000-year providence of restoration was to send the Messiah. He thought that by killing the Messiah, he could destroy the entire providence of God. In the end, God handed over Jesus to Satan as the condition of indemnity to save all of humankind. Jesus was the sacrifice for our sins. This is from Father Moon. Through the crucifixion, Jesus took on responsibility for the 4,000-year history of the dispensation and the responsibility of the ancestors. So Saturday was called Silent or Black Saturday, when Jesus, the tradition is, he descends into the spirit world, into hell, and even going into the deepest depths of hell to be able to open up the pathway to salvation and liberation. Fortunately, the story does not end there. Sunday morning, we read in the Luke, I'm going to read the first chapter, is the Resurrection Sunday. And here's how the verse goes. This is from Luke 24. It's the first to the sixth chapter. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, he has risen. Christ is risen.
Yes,
yeah, Christ is risen. Come on now.
Risen,
Christ is risen.
Yes, risen
indeed. Amen. So we read that for the next 40 days, Jesus makes a condition to gather together his disciples. He works with them to build a foundation. And this is really the foundation that Christianity stands upon, is resurrection, the victory of his resurrection. Again, this is from Father Moon. Jesus' resurrection was the first representation of the glory of heaven and the glory of victory won in the fight with Satan in the 4,000-year history. So in spite of the tragedy of the crucifixion, the victory is in the resurrection. So God was able to open up the way and lay the foundation for the Messiah to come again 2,000 years ago, our true parents. Additionally, we celebrate in this time of year for our own movement the foundation for our church, because it was an Easter Sunday was a time when Jesus Christ called Sun Myung Moon, our founder, to his mission. This is a depiction of the experience. And I'm going to read from the book of Father Moon's autobiography, The Peace-Loving Global Citizen, where he writes about his encounter and his experience with Jesus on Easter. It was the night before Easter in the year I turned 16. I was on Mount Myodu, praying all night and begging God in tears for answers. Why had he created a world so filled with sorrow and despair? Why was the all-knowing and all-powerful God leaving the world in such pain? What should I do for my tragic homeland? I wept in tears as I asked these questions repeatedly. This is 1935 in Korea. Early Easter morning, after I'd spent the entire night in prayer, Jesus appeared before me. He appeared in an instant, like a gust of wind, and said to me, "God is in great sorrow because of the pain of humankind. You must take on a special mission on earth having to do with heaven's work." That day, I saw clearly the sorrowful face of Jesus. I heard his voice clearly. The experience of witnessing the manifestation of Jesus caused my body to shake violently, like quaking aspen leaves trembling in a strong breeze. I was simultaneously overcome with fear so great I felt I might die, and gratitude so profound I felt I might explode. Jesus spoke clearly about the work I would have to do. His words were extraordinary, having to do with saving humanity from its suffering and bringing joy to God. If you don't have a copy of this book, The Peace-Loving Global Citizen, you know, let me know. We have a free copy for you. Marriage and family is at the center of the mission that Jesus called Reverend Sun Myung Moon, our founder, Father Moon, to take on. The family is the key to God's ideal in this world, the foundation for the heavenly kingdom. And marriage and rededication of marriage has been one of the cornerstones of our movement. Across religious traditions, the affirmation and the rededication of marriages with God at the center to create one global family across religious traditions, across nationalities and cultures, centered on God, we are one human family. Actually, in our tradition, that beginning of these rededication, these of marriage, began 57 years ago. And last week we celebrated the 57th anniversary of a true parents' blessing ceremony and the beginning of the ceremony of blessing and rededication. Save the family. That's the fundamental mission and role. If we can save the family, that's the foundation for building a true world of peace. And we know Father Moon did many different projects and activities, but at the core of everything was, how do we bring the family back to God so God can dwell powerfully in the family, especially for the benefit of the children? So last week, Peter Meef and I, we were absent, not here. We were at a conference in Las Vegas dealing with saving the family, and particularly focus, it's called the High Noon Summit, dealing with sexual integrity. Satan has used sexuality to attack the family so deeply and so profoundly. And the conference was called the High Noon Summit. You know, at high noon, you have no shadows, no dark places where Satan can hide. So the vision of a high noon conference means bringing everything out so it can be healed, cleansed, and corrected. So I want to take a couple minutes and just share something about the core mission of the Messiah. The core vision for God's building of the kingdom of heaven on earth is the family. And to do that, we have to deal with Satan's very active attacks on the family that are happening right now. The first day and a half or so, it was a lot of talk, a lot of scary talk about the problem and the reality of pornography and the attack and the consequences of this sin on families and our society and environment. In fact, they made the point that you should see this as not just an individual problem, but this is a public health issue. So many people say, oh, you know, well, what I do on my own, it doesn't hurt anything, it doesn't harm anyone. But actually, in this first couple of days of the conference, they brought research study after research study, scientific studies pointing out the damage that pornography causes to the society, as well as to relationships and families, as well as to the physical and emotional well-being of individuals. It's a public health issue that's challenging everyone. On the individual level, it affects the brain. They talk a lot about neuroplasticity and how images like that affect our brain and our emotions and feelings. How it affects anxiety, depression, even the latest thing is impotence, you know, erectile dysfunction. The fundamental cause of that is viewing pornography. And that's how some people, not non-religious people, who didn't care that it's morally wrong, that it's a sin, it's not God's ideal, they don't care. But man, my physical body's not working anymore. Doctor, help me. The first question they ask is, well, are you watching pornography? Well, yeah, so what? Well, that's one of the fundamental reasons you're having a problem. Oh, suddenly it becomes an important issue. They went beyond that, though. Not just individual problems, but in relationship, and particularly when we talk about the family and husband-wife relationship, pornography damages marriages. It blocks the ability to commit to each other. God's vision of the relationship between husband and wife that God raised up from the very beginning, His hope was Adam and Eve would be a true husband and wife. Hope for each one of us is that we can be a true couple that God can dwell in. That's the hope that we grow up for, looking for this ideal love that we want to see. Pornography gets in the way and blocks that. It creates a vision of the relationship is not of two divine beings interacting, uniting with God at the center, but instead it normalizes violence towards each other. You know, the horrible movies like The 50 Shades of Stupid, right? You know, that supports and just says, oh yeah, you know, if you just let him beat you, then he'll turn into a good man in the end. This is horrific and horrible and so far from God's ideal. This is the whole idea of watching this. It makes our partner into just an object, a tool that we use to find joy ourselves instead of a relationship that we create love and joy that God can dwell in. But they went beyond that. No, it's not just the problems for individuals, not just for problems for a couple or a family, but actually it affects society in profound ways. You know, pornography exploits women and children. It multiplies violence, particularly sexual violence, and makes violence seem like it's more acceptable. They showed lots of studies and statistics that even someone who's viewing it thinks, oh, you know, a rapist, nah, you know, it's not so terribly bad. Just because they've been watching horrible, horrific violence being done in the sexual act. sex trafficking? You know, we've talked about this a number of times. What creates the need for sex trafficking? Pornography. Who are the people who are being viewed in that? Often sex trafficked young people. So it's having a substantial effect in this world. But I tell you, in those first 2 days, it was quite horrific. And on top of that, there were some deep, heartfelt testimonies from young people who've grown up in our church talking about their addiction to pornography. And even talking, I know God's ideal, and yet I've been captured by this, and I can't overcome it. And even knowing blessed marriages that are broken apart because of the problem of pornography. Such a serious, serious issue. And if we'd stopped there, I probably would have got home and slept for a week, because I just, you know, it was depressing and terrifying. Because also they talked about how available it is now. You know, anyone that has a smartphone has something that can be filled with pornography. One of the presenters talked about his house is like Fort Knox. You know, he's got filters. He's got ninjas standing on top of his house to make sure no pornography gets into his house. So what happens? Oh, he sees his 8-year-old, his friends over there, you know, with their iPhone, and they're playing a game on the iPhone. You know, oh, that's nice. He walks by, and he sees them kind of making this slam. Ooh, dad's there. Oh, you know, the parental antenna goes up. Something's going on over here. So he goes over to see what they're watching. And he looks through it, and he's flipping through the phone, and he sees all this graphic pornography. And pornography today is not just pictures of naked people. It's violent acts being done. Multiple partners, all kinds of strange things. It's horrific. So how are we going to deal with that? How can we deal with somebody so powerful, so addictive, that deals with the core root of evil? You know, from the fall of man to the most important and precious thing, that God's vision of the ideal love between a husband and wife. It's such a powerful, powerful tool. Fortunately, the second day brought us more hope. Because they shared a lot of programs and activities. This conference was a follow-up for a conference that happened last year. It's called the Set Free Conference. Josh McDowell, he's a famous for his work with Campus Crusade for Christ. And he organized this conference realizing this is a huge issue that's having direct impact in our congregations, in our churches, and in our families, as well as the larger community. So with this scary news, we also had some fantastic presenters who shared about their work. And I'm just going to flip through quickly and show you some of the websites, because there's lots of hope, you know, in these programs and solutions. One I really encourage you to look at, fightthenewdrug.org. Now, you know, I put spaces in there. It's in the website, there's no spaces. So fightthedrug.org. Great site. It's aimed at young people. It's trendy. It's got lots of incredible information. You can see, you know, porn affects the brain, relationships, and society. And you can click on that and see all kinds of information. They've really taken the role of making it something. They have t-shirts, you know, hats. They have all kinds of things you can do. You can join a club, get information. There's a whole movement that they're developing that's particularly targeted at young people. And also they've developed an application for your phone that educates about pornography. And it's free. This web-based program is free to teenagers. And it's to empower them to be free from pornography, to give education and understanding about its damage and how to be free of it. Very powerful site. Please, please visit that site, fightthenewdrug.org. Clay Olson, who's presenting, was a great presenter, very, very inspiring and motivating. Then also, Bravehearts, this is Michael Leahy, who does in-depth mentoring with people, because this is no small addiction. It's a very challenging, challenging issue. And he's worked coaching people, other people, to also support as mentors in dealing with this problem. His website also has lots of information. I think I sent out links, and I'll send these out again. But on his site, you can actually see a lot of the videos from that Set Free Summit. And there is Covenant Eyes there. This is giving us particularly the hope families. And the nice thing, this is software that you install on your children's phones or computers, or if you're mentoring or trying to support some to overcome the addiction, that they can put on there, and it's an accountability software. It's not a filter. Now, the interesting thing, and I really appreciate he brought this out, is that we can't block, you know, you can put blocks, but if you have a teenager, they can get around any block, you know. It's like, yeah, oh, give me a little challenge, right? I can get past that block that you put on my computer. But what this does is basically just monitors. When young people see, you know, visit, you know, a pornography site, see pornographic images, then you get an email. You get an alert. And it happens, and the purpose is not to, you know, oh, let me go in and I'm going to beat you up because you did that. No, the purpose is you've just been exposed to something damaging to your spirit and to your heart, something that creates trauma in your mind. And let's have a relationship. Let's talk about this. Let's get past this, you know, so you can understand, you know, what true love really is. So he emphasized over and over, it's not about blocking it, because you can't. No matter how much you try, everyone, you know, is going to be exposed to pornography. We need to be able to be the people that they can talk to about it, to address it, to overcome it, and to know how to digest this stuff that we're being poisoned with. But probably the most hopeful was this site, endsexualexploitation.org. This site is the National Center on Sexual Exploitation. And they're the people who are making this push that this is a public health crisis. And the point, like you see there, pornography fuels sex trafficking. It fuels child sexual abuse and sexual violence, like rape, and so many things. This is a public health issue. It's not just, oh yeah, you can do what you want. Because what you want is now damaging people. He gave the analogy, you know, if you see a person in a boat, you know, and he's under his seat and he's drilling a hole in the boat. You know, he says, hey, this is my seat. I can do what I want. No, you can't do what you want, because if you drill a hole in that boat, this boat is going to sink and everybody in the boat. Pornography is that kind of poison in our environment. So this site, again, I encourage you to look at this. Remember, there's no spaces. EndSexualExploitation.org. They have what's called the Dirty Dozen list. This is where they list companies that are promoting pornography. Now, it's a scary thing. You look at that list. What? Amazon.com, right? How about the American Library Association? That's really scary. Amnesty International? Hey, I thought they were the good guys, right? Comcast, Roku, Snapchat, Twitter, YouTube. Nope. And if you go to the website, I encourage you, see why they made that. That Dirty Dozen list. The hopeful thing is that this is the latest list. Last year, they had Walmart, they had the Hilton Hotels, the Hyatt Hotels, they even had the Department of Defense on this list. But they're not on this list anymore. Because Hilton and Hyatt, and actually many of the major hotel chains, have taken pay-per-view pornography out of the options for their home, for the... That was a huge thing. Satan loved when guys would go on a business trip and be in a hotel. No one knows. I can watch this porn stuff, get addicted, get poisoned, you know. And so they got it actually taken out of those hotels. The military BXs, the exchanges on military bases all around the world sold pornographic magazines. And they got them to remove them from sale. And same thing with Walmart. So I encourage you to check out this website, endsexualexploitation.org. Because the point that they kept making is that, and there's lots of things for action, because we need to heal the world, because what does God want? What's God looking for? True love. We want true love in our lives. God wants to see us living lives of fulfillment with a genuine, true love relationship between husband and wife. This organization, the End Sexual Exploitation people, they said four key points that we need to repeat over and over to people who say, oh, pornography doesn't hurt anyone. That number one, we need to repeat again and again, Pornography harms children. It normalizes violence towards women. It leads to addiction and dependencies, and it's connected to the increased demand for sex trafficking, sexual violence, even rape and sexual exploitation. This is a public health issue. So it was quite inspiring to hear the victories that she's had, and this website points to a lot of concrete actions that we can take. And then finally, this is a site that's set up, Pure Mind Online, by Unificationists, particularly bringing together a lot of these different resources, but it's not part of the church, it's a separate nonprofit organization, to bring a vision of what is true sexual integrity and fulfilling relationship between husband and wife. This is the hope for the future, is that we can build, we can provide an alternative vision to the false lie about sexuality that's being promoted in the world today. The third day, the presentation's focused on the unification vision of true husband-wife love and relationships. And we had some great testimonies, powerful testimonies from older couples and then the young couples who've grown up in the church. Their challenges, how they face the challenges of pornography, but also how their commitment to each other. By following the vision of living for the sake of others, particularly in the husband-wife relationship. Actually, Father Moon has lots of words to say about this. Sometimes embarrassing words, right? You know, your sexual organ belongs to your spouse, not to you. What? Okay. Sexual organ? What's the religious leader doing talking about sexual organs, right? But living, God wants that relationship between husband and wife to be the most precious and beautiful experience where God can dwell. So living for your spouse is something pornography definitely doesn't promote. No, how do I bring joy to my partner in my relationship? So I really was hopeful in that third day where they gave the vision, not just, oh yeah, it's really bad and it causes damages, it hurts people, and here's the things you can do, but cultivating and nurturing a vision for how do we cultivate and develop genuine intimacy in the relationship between husband and wife with God at the center. So, Easter time. What a strange time to talk about such a horrific challenge, right? Kind of like, oh man, I told my mom this is a topic and she said, what? How could you do that? How could you talk about that on Easter? But the truth is, Easter is a time for resurrection, for being reborn, to starting new, for moving from death to life, right? Pornography, the sex trade, the destruction of families, the evil influence of pornography in our environment is destroying God's ideal, is poisoning God's ideal, and it's just like death. So we need to resurrect. There's no other time than to resurrect. And the truth is that all of us have dealt with it. You know, if you're on the internet, you've seen it. And I want to encourage it, especially after hearing the many heartfelt, painful testimonies from people honestly sharing about their struggle with their addiction to pornography. I want to encourage brothers, please check yourselves. If you're looking at pornography, you have an issue. Please call me. I'm not a therapist. I don't have the answers. But over and over we heard, the only way to overcome this addiction is with a partner. And it's not going to be your spouse, because looking at pornography is hurting and damaging, killing your spouse. We need a partner to support us, to hold us accountable. It's based on the Alcoholics Anonymous sponsor model. To have an accountability partner that can support us. And I know in the past I've been kind of glib about that. Oh, you know, you have a problem? Stop. You know you're not supposed to do that. Don't do that anymore. Without recognizing the real challenge of addiction that it is. If you're a sister, please call Eleanor. You know, and let's look to see the way that we can deal with this first in our own families, in our own lives. And honestly, it's a serious fight. It's a serious struggle. The thing is, we have hope, right? No matter how black, how dark it gets, we have hope. Jesus' crucifixion was probably the most tragic, sad, and horrible day for God, for God's providence, for humanity. Because the hope of humankind was murdered on the cross. How dark was that day? How hopeless was that moment? And yet we always have hope because of the resurrection. Jesus' victory over death, over the cross. In our lives, we often need resurrection. We need to come back to life. And we can't do it on our own. Also, we have hope because we can always remember and know the sacrifices that have been made for us, the foundation we stand on, but especially that God is our loving parent who absolutely loves and cares for us, is desperate to bring us back, to know God's full love, full parental heart, and to be able to express that in our relationships and in our lives. Let me close with this quote from Father Moon. Let the grace of resurrection, the blissful taste of new life, and the grace of new life be granted to as many people as possible. In this way, let this be the hour when we can return the glory of the resurrection of new life to Heavenly Father. Adieu. Please join me in prayer. Good morning, Father, Mother, God, our honorable minimum, our loving Heavenly Parent. Thank you for the amazing victory that we can inherit because of Jesus' absolute love, incredible sacrifice and perseverance and never giving up, even going to the pits of hell. Jesus Christ brought resurrection and rebirth. Heavenly Parent, we know that 2,000 years of your province of restoration. You've always longed to see your children coming back to you, to know your love and to experience your fullness. Heavenly Parent, we want to come before you and in this moment as each of us prays and reflects and connects with you. Heavenly Parent, we want to offer up to you the challenges that we faced, either in our relationships with our spouse or partner, the influence of this pornographic and evil environment on our lives. Heavenly Parent, we want to start anew. Heavenly Parent, we want to be reborn as sons and daughters who know your love and can express your love, free from Satan's attack on the most precious thing, your ideal of love between husband and wife. Heavenly Parent, this Easter morning is certainly a time for us to experience joy and to celebrate the victory. But Heavenly Parent, most importantly, we want to claim that victory ourselves. Fulfill our responsibility and take the actions you need us to do to break free and to truly be children that represent your love and presence in this world. So Heavenly Parent, as your sons and daughters, as blessed central families, we determine and rededicate ourselves to you this beautiful Easter morning. Amen. And not you. Okay, everybody, thank you. Please turn to your neighbor and talk about the challenges of creating a true love family.